All right, so just want to finish up the discussion of the Elmore delay formula that we had in the last class with a specific case of applying it to the context of a long wire, right? So we saw that in the general case of a tree structured network, right? So you have one source point where a voltage change is applied and you have some kind of a branching tree structure whereby that network is then being applied to many different points, right? So under those conditions, we essentially saw how we can derive the time constant to any given target point in that network, right? What we are going to consider is a much more simplified version of that, which is simply one long wire, okay? So the situation that we have is there is a source, there is a long wire, and there is a target or destination. And we are interested in what happens when we apply a pulse input, or rather not a pulse, a step input over here. How much time is required for the delay, the 50% propagation or 60% propagation, so at the RC time constant, in other words, that you are going to see at the output stage. Okay, so the first approximation that we can have, or the in order to sort of apply this properly, what we are saying is, in general, this wire is going to have a certain thickness, an area of cross section, and therefore it is possible to define a resistivity or a resistance per unit length. Okay. And similarly, there is also a capacitance per unit length. Of the wire, right? Now, why do we say that both of these things are per unit length? Because essentially we are considering that the wire is some kind of a metal sheet like this, right? It has a certain area of cross section. And a certain height above the insulating layer, or the substrate. And what we have in between is the height of the insulating layer. Right? Once we know these parameters, essentially everything else that we have is related to the resistivity of the material, the permittivity of the insulator, and so on, right? So it's possible to actually calculate the resistance per unit length and capacitance per unit length. So if the wire itself has a complete length of some L, right, where this is some number of microns or millimeters or whatever it is, some measure of length of the wire, right, the total resistance is therefore going to be given by capital R equals small r times L, and capital C is equal to small c times L. Okay, basically the per unit length parameters multiplied by the length itself. Okay, so first estimate, or what we call the lumped parameter estimate, says that I should treat this entire wire as one resistance followed by one capacitance with values R and C, and therefore the tau, the time constant, is going to be given by RC, right? Now, there's one interesting thing that you can see over here. It is basically going to be given by small r into C into L squared, okay? But there is a problem over here. This is not really correct in the sense that I cannot sort of separate out all the resistance, just group it into one, separate out all the capacitance, group it into one. That's not really the correct result that I have, right? That's not the structure that I have. It's not one resistance followed by a capacitance. What I have is a continuous resistance and also a continuous capacitance going to ground. So the question becomes, how does this differ? And it turns out that if we apply the Elmore formula on this, we get a different result. Okay. So what? How would we do that? Essentially, what we are going to say is, let me take that same wire and break it up into a number of small segments. Where each of these segments has some length small l, which is given by capital L divided by n, where n is the number of segments. Okay, and these segments are assumed to be connected by some ideal connectivity which has zero resistance and zero capacitance. Okay, in principle, I mean, they are actually, you know, in practice what happens is those segments are actually just contiguous, so there is no wire or anything connecting them, right? Which means that the equivalent circuit model that I have now looks like this. I have a resistance, a capacitance going to ground. Another resistance, a capacitance going to ground. Third resistance, capacitance going to ground, and so on. Right? Large number of such segments. Until I have the last stage, which is the destination. Yeah. Yes. The grounds will always be the same even for a tree. See, the tree was only with regard to the branching structure used for the resistance network. Right? All the capacitors are assumed to go to ground. That was the case even for the Elmore network that we considered earlier. Right? The capacitances are always between a branch point and ground. So the tree structure is only for the resistances. Right? And in this case, this is a trivial tree. There is one root, there is one leaf, and there is just a series of resistances connecting. Okay. So yes, you are right. This has to be a tree structure. In this case, it's a trivial tree structure, but the capacitances are always between the nodes and ground. That was the case even for the regular Elmore formula. Okay. So now what happens with each of these resistances? I'll call them some R prime. All of them we can expect are pretty much going to be equal because I have broken this into equal length segments, right? Where r prime is now going to be given by the small r times small l, okay? Or in other words, small r into capital L divided by n, okay? And the c prime is going to be given by c into small l, which is C into capital L divided by N. Okay. Now, what's the Elmore formula for the delay from the input to the output? How do we go about calculating the Elmore delay? We have a source, we have a destination. That at every one of the branch points, we need to see the capacitance, or for every one of the capacitances, we need to find out what is the shared resistance between that capacitance, the path to that capacitance, and the path to the destination. In this case, all the capacitors are on the path to the destination, which means that whatever resistance is there up to that capacitance is what I need to consider. Okay? So the overall time constant is going to be given by the first C prime into R prime, okay, that corresponds to this, then plus the second C prime into 2R prime, okay, that corresponds to this capacitance, right, and so on. The third one will contribute 3R prime, until finally I have C prime into n minus 1 R prime, and finally C prime into n R prime. This is for the very last stage. Okay. So what happens once I take out C prime R prime as a common factor? I get C prime R prime into 1 plus 2 plus 3 up to n. How much is this? N into n plus 1 by 2, right? So C prime R prime n into n plus 1 by 2. Okay, replace C prime and R prime by the capital C by n and small c by n, right? They are all 1 by nth of the original one, right? C prime is equal to capital C by n, R prime is equal to capital R by n. So replace this, tau becomes equal to R C by n squared into n plus 1 by 2. Okay, now let n tend to infinity, because that's what we want to do, right? We are sort of saying, okay, I'll break it up into segments. How many segments? Ideally as many as possible. So I just want that number to tend to infinity and take the limit, right? So this becomes RC by n square, n into n plus 1 by 2, right, will become RC by 2. Okay, so you see what happened. When we apply the Elmore formula, it's telling us that yes, it is proportional to the R, it is proportional to the C, but that proportionality constant, there can be a big difference. In other words, if you straight away use the lumped model, as opposed to this is what is called a distributed model, right? So a distributed model, in the sense that I am taking a long wire and breaking it up into several segments, adding up the total effect, right? The distributed model gives you a more accurate estimate because it is closer to the physical reality, right? And what it's telling you is the physical reality tells us that the estimate of the time constant that we get, RC by 2, is only half of the RC that we would have normally got if we just straight away applied the lumped model. Please raise your hand, I'm not able to see it. Yeah. You mean the Elmore formula?
Yes.
So the Elmore formula does not specify, at least not that I know of, I don't know of any specification where it tells you when it can be ignored, right? Typically what you'll find in practice is that if one of the R's or one of the C's is significantly larger than the others, then that will sort of skew the results a lot more further away from what the Elmore formula will predict than in the other case, right? But as such, it does not sort of put a condition and say only if these conditions are satisfied, then the Elmore formula holds. I mean, there are some things that you can sort of get over there, but ultimately it sort of boils down to whether the second order terms are negligible or not. And the only way of doing that in some sense is to actually calculate the second order terms and confirm that they are negligible. So there is no sort of precondition that you can say under these conditions Elmore delay formula will work. Okay. Alright, so where are we going with this? The purpose of this exercise was to show that in a number of situations, if you did not use the Elmore formula, if you straight away use the lump capacitance resistance formula, you could be off by a factor of 2, 100% essentially in your estimate. Okay. Now this is a very simple case, straight wire. When you have a more complex network like a clock tree, for example, where there is a lot of branching, if you then try to take a total resistance across the tree and a total capacitance, it's not even very meaningful because the total resistance does not make sense, right? You are not just adding up the resistances of all the segments. So in such a case, you have to apply the Elmore formula. There's no other way of really computing the delays to individual points. Okay. Now, having said all of that, the next thing that you need to keep in mind is the Elmore formula itself is an approximation. As he pointed out, under what conditions does it hold, right? There's no sort of precondition that I can straight away say if this is satisfied, then the Elmore delay will give you within so many percentage of your final result. We don't have a sort of simple way of estimating that. So in practice, the VLSI design tools, the timing analysis tools, don't just rely on the Elmore formula. They have more accurate formulas that they use in order to estimate the delays, right? Which sort of try to take into account second order terms and so on without calculating the full transfer function, right? Elmore formula is useful once again for hand calculation. So a lot of the things that we are doing in this course as we go along, that's one thing to keep in mind. The first order level one equation of the transistor, right? The velocity, saturation, and the common equation for current. The simplified expression for the diffusion capacitances as well as the gate capacitances. Elmore delay formula for wire and interconnect, right? All of those are approximations that we are making so that we can do hand calculations and we can actually design circuits without needing to go through complicated simulations for every single step. At the end of the day, what will happen is you will use this to make an estimate of what are the transistor sizes, how long should a wire be, and so on. Make an estimate of how much is your delay, therefore what should the sizes be. Plug it into an actual simulation which makes no approximations and check whether the results are validating your assumptions. If they do, then well and good, your design was good. If not, then you need to go back and figure out what went wrong, tweak, come up with new sizes, check again by simulation. So the simulations, in other words, what you're getting from SPICE are fairly or very accurate in the sense that they are based on very detailed physical level models. But even they are models, they are not exact. So an actual transistor that you measure will have slightly different characteristics. Okay? But these are close enough that they can be used as a very good estimate of what the final results are going to be. What we are working with now are very rough estimates. SPICE gives you very good estimates of the same thing. Okay? The reason why we are doing all this is so that we can do design without needing to go to simulations at every step. Okay. Alright, so RC by 2 versus RC. Right, that's the primary sort of takeaway from this entire analysis. The Elmore formula shows us that there is a significant overestimate of the time constant if we just use a lumped model. Okay. The second thing to take away from this, which is true either for the Elmore formula or the lumped model, is this fact that tau is proportional to L square. Right? Whether you take the Elmore formula or the lumped model, you find that it's r small c into L square by 2 or L square directly. Right? This tells you that long wires are doubly problematic. It's not just that they have a long resistance and therefore the delay will increase, it will actually increase quadratically. Right, so delay increases quadratically with length. Okay. Alright, so with this we will stop the discussion of the Elmore formula. Like I said, we will be applying it in a few other places when we are looking at how the delay through a transistor is to be measured and so on, or through a gate is to be measured, and also in a couple of other places where we are trying to use the delay through wires or interconnect as well. Okay? But now what we are going to do is move on to the next stage, which is the construction of basic gates. Okay? So all this while we have been talking about transistors, and the entire analysis has been on in what ways does a transistor differ from an ideal switch. Okay, we want it to behave like a voltage controlled switch. In practice it does do that, but it's not an ideal switch. It has all of these problems, right? It needs a threshold voltage before it can turn on. The amount of current is proportional, and it's not proportional but is related to the threshold voltage, to the applied gate voltage, to the drain source voltage, right? Number of different parameters. It has a finite resistance which prevents ideal flow of current. It has capacitances associated with it which will cause a certain delay in the amount of time it takes for the voltage at a point to rise or fall, right? So all of those will study are the non-idealities of switches, right? Now what we are going to do is actually start implementing gates, more complex gates using these switches, and then study what impact those non-idealities have on the implementation of the gates. Okay. So the first and simplest gate that we are going to consider is the CMOS inverter. Okay. So first things first, what, forget the word CMOS, what is an inverter supposed to do? in digital logic, what is a same, what is an inverter supposed to behave like? When it gets a 0 input, it's supposed to give a 1 as output, and when it gets a 1 as input, it's supposed to give a 0 as output. Okay? This is the logical symbol used to indicate an inverter. The truth table, it has 1 input, 1 output. This is it. Right? So this sort of completely defines the inverter. Okay? Now, we have specified only the endpoints, 0 and 1. When we are actually going to build a gate to implement this inverter, we will have to make certain choices. What is 0? What is 1? How do we represent these values? Okay? And what we do is, we decide to say, I will take the ground potential to represent 0 and VDD, the supply voltage, to represent 1. Okay? This is an arbitrary mapping. It's a choice that I have made. Keep that in mind. There's nothing fundamentally telling you that 0 has to be mapped to ground and 1 has to be mapped to VDD. There are, in fact, some logic families where you will find the thing reversed. Right? But the point is, this is simple and straightforward and easy to understand. So we make this assumption and go forward with it. Okay? What does this mean? It means that the 0 and the VDD outputs, inputs and outputs, are defined well, what we expect. But this is a real system. It can also have a voltage anywhere between those points, between 0 and VDD. Okay? So the question becomes, what should my inverter behave like when the voltage is somewhere between 0 to VDD? Okay? And that essentially takes us to the concept of a so-called voltage transfer characteristic. Or a VTC. Okay? Sort of like a transfer function, except that it's not a function of frequency, it's a function of input voltage. What is the output voltage as a function of the input voltage? Okay? So, before we get to the CMOS inverter, what should the voltage transfer characteristic look like for an ideal inverter? First of all, what are the axes? We have, what's on the y-axis? The Vout, right? On the x-axis is Vin. Okay? What are the limits within which I am interested? 0 to VDD. Right? So on both axes, I am going to assume that I am interested in the range 0 to VDD. Okay? Now, is this an inverter? If I had this kind of behavior, is this an inverter? Huh? By the way, this is an inverter. There's nothing wrong with it. Okay? In the sense that it behaves the way that we expect at the endpoints. So it is correct. It is logically an inverter. But when I say there's nothing wrong with it, I'm exaggerating. There is something wrong with it. It's not a good inverter. So the question becomes, what is not good about it and what do we want to fix? Okay? So if I'm interested only in the endpoints, this is perfectly fine as an inverter. Okay? What I would like to see though in an inverter is not something like this. Admittedly, you know, the input maybe varies from 0 to VDD, but I don't want the output also to do that. As far as the output is concerned, I would like it to be only 0 or VDD, a proper digital output. Okay? So let's say that I have a situation where I say the output is going to be very good. It's a digital output. It takes values either 0 or VDD. Nothing in between. Okay? In that case, what about something like this? It's VDD for some time. Suddenly switches to 0, becomes 0 the rest of the time. Is this okay as an inverter? Huh? But what is wrong with that? After all, your input is supposed to be zero. Why would I expect my input not to be zero? If I am anyway feeding the output of one gate to another gate, so you need to think a bit about that, right? Don't just take it for granted that you need this gap, right? So in other words, I think what we are coming to is that the ideal inverter will actually end up looking like this. It will be 0 up to this point and VDD up to this point. Exactly at this midway point, it will switch. Okay? Does everyone agree that this looks close to what an ideal inverter should look like? Right? So what should it be? Pretty much up to some midpoint over here, right? It remains at VDD. Then it suddenly decides, okay, now the input has gone high, the output needs to go low, abruptly switches over to the other side, and the output becomes zero. Okay? In which case, what should this this point be? At which point should it switch? VDD by 2. Why are we saying that? This is just out of some sense of symmetry that we have, right? We would like the two sides to be equal. The amount of leeway that I have on the low side should be exactly the same as what I have on the high side. Okay? It's not something fundamentally necessary to the design of an inverter. It's just something that from a symmetry point of view, I would like to see. Okay? So this VM, the midpoint voltage, should ideally be VDD by 2. Okay? Now, what if instead I have yet another curve which looks something like okay, I think the green is not very visible, but let me try some other color. Okay, something else which is a smoother curve. It's not one of those abrupt transitions. Okay, is this an ideal inverter, or is it good enough, or what would you say about this? So this is sort of getting there in the sense that it satisfies some of our requirements. It's zero at the input, or rather VDD at the when input is zero, or zero when the input is VDD. It seems to go through a transition point midway through there, which is more or less symmetric. But for some values of VDD of input which are not equal to 0 or VDD, the output is again not 0 or VDD, right? So in that sense, the output is not ideal at this point. Okay? So this brown curve is sort of somewhere in between. It's an approximation of both of the things that we had earlier, right? So what we are going to see now is, okay, so what was, in order to understand this clearly, let's think about it. What was wrong with the first one, the red curve? Why was it that we all sort of pretty much intuitively said this is not a good inverter? Output is not always stuck to 0 or VDD. But then for the brown curve also, it is not stuck to 0 or VDD. But we say that the brown curve is better than the red curve. Why? Slope. See, one thing, please be careful of using the word fast over here. There is no concept of time. We are talking about a static characteristic, right? This is a DC characteristic, right? Yeah. So what we are saying is the slope on that brown curve, right? The rate at which it changes as we, again, I'm using the word rate, but rate as a function of the input voltage, not as a function of time, okay? Remember that all of this thing, we have to be careful that we are not confusing it with a transition in time, even though it looks like what the following transitions will look like. Okay? But for a given change in input voltage, how fast is the transition in the output voltage? Right? To contrast that, in fact, we can look at another two possible examples. One of them looks like this. The other one is a transfer function which looks like this. As far as the endpoints are concerned, they are both valid. Both are inverters. Okay? But the red one is not a good inverter, because what happens is for any slight change in the input, away from either 0 or VDD, the output changes very dramatically away from 0 or VDD. Whereas for the black curve, even if the input sort of varies in this range, the output varies in a very small range. It doesn't change much at all. Same way the input changes over here. Right? The output changes only between these two points. Okay? So in other words, even if the input is noisy or something has happened to sort of change the input away from a perfect 0 or a VDD, why would that happen? We don't know. There might be situations under which I have some input voltage which is not at its ideal final value, right? 0 or VDD. What I would like is that the output pushes me back to either 0 or VDD. Right? So this curve, in other words, has a property that is called restoring. Right? Or it's a form of so-called restoring logic. What it says is, even if the input is not quite a perfect 0 or VDD, the output will be closer to a 0 or a VDD. Right? Whereas this other red curve over here, what happens? If I consider the same thing, right? For this change in input, I'll find that the change in output is this much. And for this change in input, the change in output is this much. Okay? I can't call it non-restoring because, no, it sort of amplifies the effect of any noise. Right? Any variation in the input shows up at the output with a larger magnitude. So in that sense, it is a poor design. Okay? Undesirable. Right? So that effectively is what it's telling us. Ideally, we should have that at 0 and VDD, we know exactly what the output values are supposed to be. As I move away from 0 or VDD, I would like the output to remain close to 0 or VDD for as long as possible, and then very quickly sort of transition from one to the other. Once again, quickly in the sense of rate of change of voltage, not time. Okay? So as long as that condition is satisfied, I'll say, okay, this at least looks like a good inverter characteristic. So this black curve that I have over here is sort of what I would consider desirable. Whereas the red curve is definitely a bad idea. Okay? To put it another way, supposing I have a chain of inverters. Right? Something like this. And what I have over here is a very noisy signal, something which looks like this, and then, you know, transitions over here and again looks like this. What do I expect at the output of the first stage? That variation which I saw at the input of the first inverter should be reduced. By the next stage, it should be even smaller. Sorry, did the other way around. By the next stage, it will be even smaller. By the third stage, we should be looking at something which looks almost ideal. Okay? So these gates have a property whereby they sort of reject noise that is there on the input signal and clean up the signal and make it look more like a proper digital signal should. That is a desirable property. That is essentially what we are looking for. Okay? So overall, what we are saying is the black curve that we have in this diagram over here is pretty much what we would like to see as far as what the final characteristic or what the voltage transfer characteristic of an inverter should look like. Okay? Alright. So now that we know what we are looking for in the final characteristic, let's see how we could get such a behavior by using transistors. Okay? What we have is there is an input. There is an output, input varies from 0 to VDD, output should also vary from 0 to VDD. How do I get the behavior that whenever the input is high, the output becomes low and vice versa? Right? What I am going to say before I get to the actual PMOS and NMOS is, look, I will take this input and say that when the input is high, I want the output to go low. Right? How do I do that? I can put a sort of pull down network over here through a switch and connect it to ground and activate it using this input. Okay? Right? If I can do that, if I can put a switch of this sort over here, it will give me the correct behavior, at least for the case where VN is high. Okay? But when VN is low, I am saying that switch is going to be open. If I just left it at that, then what would happen to the Vout? I don't know, it's floating. I can't say what voltage is going to be there at Vout. So to take care of that, I put another switch going to VDD. But now I connect it to VN through a inverting gate. So when VN is low, this switch is closed. Okay? You can connect Vout? Exactly. So that's another way that we are going to look at it. I'm talking about CMOS right now. We'll look at that later. Okay, so the suggestion that he had was, instead of doing this, why not just connect Vout to VDD through a resistor? Okay, you can do that, it will work. There are problems with it. What are the problems? We'll see that later. Okay, right now this is a sort of perfect ideal inverter, because these are ideal switches. They do exactly what we want. When VN is in is high, Vout is pulled low. When VN is low, Vout is pulled high. Then we in the somewhere in between, we don't know what the state of the switches is. So we are leaving that out of the picture right now. Okay. So now how do I get these switches? We know that already. The lower switch, the one which turns on when the VN is high, is a NMOS switch, NMOS transistor. Okay. So this works like this. This is Vout. The other switch which needs to turn on when VN is low can be realized using a PMOS transistor, right? So how does that work? When VN is low, the source of the PMOS is connected to VDD. Therefore, the VSG across the PMOS is going to be equal to VDD. Right, which means that the channel forms in the PMOS transistor and current can flow from drain to source, well, from source to drain in the case of the PMOS. Right, you remember that all the signs are inverted. Okay, so for the PMOS, when the source is significantly higher than the gate, a channel forms, and when that source is also higher than the drain voltage, current starts flowing. What happens when the current flows? It flows out of Vout, charges up whatever is connected at Vout. Eventually, Vout increases to the up to a point where the current stops flowing. Okay? So this is how we construct a CMOS inverter. So now let's look at its voltage transfer characteristic and understand how, what are the different parameters that influence it and how we can sort of make changes in the behavior of the inverter. Okay, so what would the voltage transfer characteristic for this look like? What happens when VN is equal to 0? How much should Vout be? Is it VDD or is it close to VDD or is it VDD minus VT or how much is it? So think about this clearly, right? What it See, partly this also depends on where Vout is connected. Okay. If Vout is connected, is just left floating, then we can't really say about what is going to happen because we don't know where the current is going to flow. Right? But assume that it is connected, let's say, to a capacitor or something, or you know, even maybe if necessary to a resistor. But no, let's just consider it as a capacitor that it's connected to. Okay? What happens? What we are going to see over there is the Vm is 0, therefore the NMOS transistor is cut off, right? No current flows through it, or at least very, very less current flows through it, because there might be some sub-threshold conduction that is going to be an order of nanoamps, right? Very small current compared to the hundreds of microamps that you typically expect in the on state of the transistor. So for all practical purposes, we can just consider the NMOS transistor to be off, no current flowing through it. What about PMOS? VSG is equal to VDD. So there is a full-blown channel formed over there, ready to conduct current. Okay? What happens if Vout is, let's say, 1 volt? Then what is VDS or the VSD of the PMOS? It will be 1.8 minus 1, so 0.8 volts. Significant amount of VSD. Right? Current will obviously flow because there is a channel, current will flow. Okay? What happens if that Vout increases? Let's say goes to 1.5 volts. Will the current stop flowing? Less current, yes, but will it stop? What is the PMOS doing? It has got, assume that there is some place for the current to flow. Okay, there is flowing into a capacitor, charging it up or something like that, but there is some place for the current to flow. This is VDD. This is 0. This is Vout. Okay. Magnitude of VDS is going to be VDD minus Vout. Right? Initially, magnitude of VDS is large. What happens with the large value of VDS? Which region of operation is the transistor going to be in? Is it cutoff or linear or saturation or velocity saturation? Either saturation or velocity saturation, depending on the value of VDSAT. Right? Let's forget VDSAT for the time being. Forget velocity saturation completely. Okay? So which mode of operation will it be? Saturation. Okay? What happens in the saturation mode? Large amount of current will flow, right? Mu n Cox W by L into VGS minus VT whole square by 2. Pretty much the maximum current that can be delivered depending on the given value of VGS. In this case, VGS is at its highest value, VDD. Right? So the maximum current that the transistor can deliver is going to flow. Which hopefully, since this is connected to some capacitor, will keep on charging that capacitor up. And the voltage at Vout will keep on increasing. At some point, that voltage gets to a stage such that VDS becomes small. By small, I mean smaller than VGS minus VT. Okay? Right? Which region of operation are we in now? The linear region, right? Where the voltage, where the current now becomes proportional to VDS. Okay? The important point is it is not 0. when will it become zero? When will that current become zero? Then VDS goes all the way to zero. Not when VDS becomes equal to VGS minus VDD minus VT or anything like that. Only when VDS goes all the way to zero will the current stop flowing. Until that point, there is a channel, there is a voltage difference, current will flow. Okay? Once again, in practice, there are some slight difficulties over there. Once VDS becomes sufficiently small, you will find that the current is tapering off. You might find that there is some leakage current going through, and it might stabilize to something where VDS is not exactly equal to zero. It might be some small delta less than VDD, but it's definitely not going to be VDD minus VT. Okay, it will be very close to 1.8 volts, if not 1.8 volts itself. If we assume that the cutoff current or cutoff region current through the NMOS is zero, then yes, this PMOS will go all the way up to 1.8 volts. Okay, so initially at least it's going to be actually equal to VDD, voltage transfer characteristic, right? During this, what happens? What region of operation is the NMOS transistor here? NMOS is cut off. What about the PMOS? PMOS is saturated, right? Because the VDS is large. What's the next change that's going to happen as I keep on increasing Vin? PMOS? Well, when will the PMOS move out of saturation? That's much later, right? Once the VDS has dropped so much. VDS has not dropped. VDS is still at VDD. PMOS comes out of saturation only when VDS drops below VGS minus VT, right? So that's not happened. What is the next change that I can expect? The NMOS turns on. Why? When VN crosses VT of the NMOS will turn on. Okay, so at 0.4 volts, what happens when the NMOS turns on? Which region of operation is it in now? The VGS is just greater than VT. Okay? What about the VDS? VDS is very small. It's effectively zero, right? Or very small, right? So initially the thing is going to be that it moves into the linear region. Okay? But what happens in the linear region is some current starts flowing. So what I'll find is there will be a current balance. Whatever current is flowing through the PMOS has to then flow through the NMOS and it remains balanced. Okay? Most of the voltage is still dropped, the VDS is still dropped across the PMOS. Only a small amount is dropping across the NMOS. But that's enough to sort of bring this down. Okay? After a while, what we end up with is, this keeps on increasing, I'll see a transition that's happening over here. Why will the transition happen? Because now the VGS minus VT across the NMOS has increased to the point where VGS minus VT is fairly large. There is a full-blown channel, there is a significant amount of current flowing through it, right? And now depending on what is the voltage, now it depends on the value of the V out, I will be in a different mode of operation, either saturation or linear region, right? Eventually at some point this will keep on decreasing because the NMOS is being increasingly activated, the channel across it is going on increasing as I increase VGS, but at the same time the VGS of the PMOS is decreasing. So that is having a weaker and weaker channel, its ability to sustain current is getting less and less. And at some point, what will happen? The PMOS will cut off and no further current will flow through it. At what point does this happen? At VDD minus VTP. Okay? And finally, all the way up to VDD we have over here. Okay. So this is pretty much what the voltage transfer characteristic of the CMOS inverter is going to look like, right? This kind of a transition as we see it. Okay. We'll stop here for now. We need to do a little bit more analysis of what are all the different regions through which the different transistors move. Why is that important? Because it allows us to estimate what are the currents that are flowing through, and also find out things like, for example, what is the midpoint voltage, what are the noise margins, and so on, we can estimate. Okay.